I would like to welcome you to the event of the Hungarian Civil Liberties Union. And I would like to especially warmly welcome our distinguished guests who will be giving presentations and sharing their experience today. And if you don't mind, I will switch to Hungarian because most of the audience is speaking Hungarian, but there is a simultaneous translation available, and you have to use channel 6 for listening to me. Jó reggelt kívánok! Kaproncai Stefánia vagyok, a Társaság a Szabadságjogokért ügyvezető igazgatója, és szeretettel üdvözlök mindenkit a Cannabis Receptre konferencia az orvosi marihuánáról című eseményünkön. A konferencia célja, hogy a terület kiemelkedő szakértőinek előadásain keresztül többet megtudjunk a cannabis gyógyászati alkalmazhatóságáról a modern orvostudományban, arról, hogy miért és hogyan engedélyezik világszerte egyre több helyen a cannabis orvosi receptre történő felírását, illetve hogy Magyarországon kik próbálják előmozdítani a gyógyászati cannabis ügyét, és milyen lépésekre lenne szükség az engedélyeztetéshez. Ezeket a kérdéseket külön panelekben járjuk majd ma körül, a konferenciát pedig egy kerekasztal beszélgetéssel zárjuk, ahol a nemzetközi és hazai tapasztalatok alapján vizsgáljuk meg, hogy miként juthatnának hozzá a magyar betegek is a gyógyászati kanabiszhoz orvosi receptre. Az ENSZ Emberi Jogok Egyetemes Nyilatkozatának 25. cikkének első pontja kimondja, hogy minden személynek joga van saját maga és családja egészségének és jólétének biztosítására alkalmas életszínvonalhoz. Ide tartozik az élelemhez, ruházathoz, lakáshoz, orvosi gondozáshoz, valamint a szükséges szociális szolgáltatásokhoz való hozzáférés. A TASZ régóta dolgozik annak érdekében, hogy tudományos bizonyítékokon alapuló ismereteket terjesszen a drogpolitikáról. És az ilyen ismeretekben összhangban álló drogpolitikáért is fellépünk. A cannabis gyógyászati célú felhasználásáról szóló konferencia megszervezésével az volt a célunk, hogy ezen a területen is minél alaposabb tudományos bizonyítékokon alapuló diskurzus induljon el a magyar szakmán belül. Ezért meghívtunk a szakma számos képviselőjét, orvostanhallgatókat, egészségügyi dolgozókat, olyan döntéshozókat, akik állami szervekben, a minisztériumban ülnek, illetve a szociális szakmában dolgozókat, ártalomcsökkentésben dolgozókat. Úgyhogy nagy szeretettel üdvözlök mindenkit, aki bármelyik szakmát képviseli, vagy akár olyat, amit nem soroltam fel. Az internetes folklórban egyre gyakoribbak azok a nézetek, amelyek a cannabiszt valamiféle univerzális gyógyszerként mutatják be, amely egy sor betegségre gyógymódot jelent. Egyesek egyenesen azt hangoztatják, hogy a cannabisz gyógyítja a rákot, és akik ezt tagadják, azok a gyógyszeripar zsoldjában állnak szerintük. Ezek a következtetések gyakran lehetnek olyan hibás logikai alapokon állók, mint a cannabiszt halálos veszélyként bemutató ellenpárjaik. Az első panelben az orvostudományi háttérrel fogunk foglalkozni. A lehetséges szabályozásról és gyógyászati alkalmazásról szóló párbeszéd érdekében hívtunk meg hazai és külföldi szakértőket, akik több szakterület felől közelítik meg a kérdést. Lesznek olyan előadóink, akik a biológiai és orvosi oldalról fognak beszámolni, mások a szabályozás közgazdasági kérdéseivel foglalkoznak. Előadóink között van kutatással foglalkozó szakember, és olyan érintett szakértő is, aki a betegszervezetek engedélyezésben való szerepéről fog beszélni. Rendkívül örülünk a magyarországi résztvevőknek és felszólaló szakértőknek. Nagyon köszönjük, hogy vállalták a felszólalást. Ők szintén több szakmai területet képviselnek, van köztük orvos, igazgatási szakember és érdekvédő is. Az előadásokat szinkrontolmácsolással tudják hallgatni, a 6-os csatornán lehet hallgatni, és a konferenciáról készült videókat pedig utólag fel fogjuk tartani a Társaság a Szabadságjogokért oldalára. A 20 perces előadásokat követően fog lehetőség nyílni néhány kérdés feltételére, és szeretnék mindenkit megkérni, hogy működjön együtt abban, hogy tartani tudjuk magunkat a programban feltüntetett időkerethez, és minden előadásra és a kerekasztalra is jusson kellő idő. Hosszú, de reményeink szerint nagyon izgalmas és tartalmas konferencia előttünk, és mindenkinek nagyon hasznos időtöltést kívánok. És mielőtt felkérném az első panel előadóit, azelőtt még egy lehetőségre szeretném felhívni azoknak az egészségügyi dolgozóknak, orvostanhallgatóknak, más egészségügyi szakmát tanulóknak a figyelmét, akik jelen vannak. Holnap délután lehetőség van egy zárt körű beszélgetésen való részvételre az eddig előadónkkal, Lumir Hanussal. És akit érdekel ez a lehetőség, azt kérném, hogy ott a regisztrációnál a kollégáimnak jelezze ezt, és ők elmondják azt, hogy mikor és hol kerül majd erre a beszélgetésre sor. Tehát még egyszer egészségügyben dolgozókat, illetve ilyen szakmák hallgatóit várjuk erre a zárt körű beszélgetésre. És akkor most nagy örömmel kérném fel az első panel előadóit, hogy fáradjanak ki ide mellém a pódiumra. Az első előadónk Lumir Ondrej Hanus, aki napjaink egyik legismertebb kanabisz kutatója. A Jeruzsálemi Héber Egyetem gyógyszerészeti iskolájában tanít és kutat, és nevéhez fűződik többek között az emberi agy belső kanabionid rendszerének feltérképezése, ami alapvető hatást gyakorolt a kanabisz kutatások irányára. Dr. Hanus a kanabisz széleskörű gyógyászati tulajdonságairól fog beszélni. Megkérném még dr. Ilja Rezsniket, hogy szintén fáradjon fel a pódiumra. Ő klinikai neuropszichiáter, fő területe a gyógyászati kanabisz és kanabisz származékok használata, főleg a neuropszichiátriai betegségek esetében, mint a krónikus fájdalom, poszttraumás stressz-szindróma, OCD, Tourette-szindróma, Parkinson-kor és az Alzheimer betegség. És a panelunk harmadik szereplője dr. Kelemen Anna, aki jelenleg vizsgáztat, úgyhogy ha jól tudom, akkor még nincsen itt, de meg fog érkezni a panelban. Ő neurológus, gyermekneurológus, pszichiáter, neuropszichológus és epileptológus. Kiemelt szakterületei az epilepszia, a gyermekepilepszia kezelése, a gyermekneurológia, az epilepszia genetika és az epilepszia sebészet. Előadásában a kanabisz alkalmazási területeit vizsgálja a neurológiában és az epileptiológiában. Még egyszer nagy szeretettel üdvözlöm a résztvevőinket, és akkor kezdődnek az előadások.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen, dear friends. Thank you very much for invitation to this wonderful city to tell you something about cannabis and endocannabinoid system. My name is Lumir Hanus. I'm originally from Czechoslovakia, where I did at Palacký University in Olomouc for 20 years from 1970 to 1990. Scientific research of cannabis, and then Professor Meshulam invited me for 1 year to Hebrew University. It was at 1990, and it extended a little bit more, so I'm over there already 26 years. So I would like to tell you about cannabis and why it's such good medicine. No, cannabis, it's very old plant. Several years ago, I was in Siberia, and when we traveled, so on the both sides of the road, miles and miles on both sides was cannabis. So probably if they need eradication over there, it will not be such easy, but it's wild cannabis, and probably it has a high amount of cannabidiol. Unfortunately, I couldn't take samples because it's very complicated. I can be arrested because of that, even when it's in the nature. But it can be also very good medicine, of course. probably the oldest human use of cannabis was in Moravia about 25,000 years ago. There excavated Czech and American archaeologists, and they found impressions of fibers. And they were not sure, it was not such good, but they were sure that it's nettle or cannabis. So if it's cannabis, so it's the oldest one. But for sure, it was in China, 1,000 years ago, as you can see, and it was used as industrial hemp for different utensils, like you can see from excavations, was shoes from cannabis. But for sure, it's around 5,000 years ago, when was mythical emperor Shennong in China, and he considered cannabis a wonderful medicine. As you can see, he called it Chu Ma. It's like Chu, this is Ma, this is symbol of cannabis, and this was Chuma, it means female cannabis, of course, and he considered it's like a superior elixir of immortality, and they use it for treatment in medicine, malaria, gout, beriberi, constipation, rheumatism, and so on. So you can see that already thousands of years ago, this was appreciated as medicinal plant. In Assyria, which ruled 1,000 years in the Middle East, at excavations were found clay tablets, and on these clay tablets was whole pharmacopoeia of that time, and as it was found, cannabis, they used different words to call it, for instance, gurguru, if it was cannabis which was used for ropes, or kunabu, if it was used for religious rites, hand of ghost, poison of limbs, it can be probably nocturnal epilepsy, and ganzi gunzu, it was what we call today psychotomimetic compound, because it was a correct translation, robber which screw up your soul. So it was in Assyria. If we look to Egypt, so in Egypt also cannabis was appreciated as medicinal plant, and they call it Shemshem too, and it was on excavation found on so-called Ebers papyrus, and on the first part, hemp ground in honey intranus in her vagina, and on another part, again, this is the word Shemshem too, a remedy for a toenail. So as you can see, to treat maybe some inflammations. In India, there are famous Vedas, and of course we know very good Rig Veda. There are also some psychotomimetic plants, but in Atharva Veda is mentioned cannabis as also as medicinal plant. Interesting were Scythians, this is in Siberia, where soil is frozen all the time, and so it preserved, because it was in permanent ice, so it preserved tombs with dead bodies, and what they found in the tomb, they found cannabis seeds, and Herodotus of Halicarnassus wrote in his history how they use it. They had hot stones, and they put the cannabis seeds on hot stone and covered themselves with blankets, and then they were influenced by vapors, and they howled like wolves, as was written. According to my opinion, these were not cannabis seeds, but what you see on the corner, on the bottom, right corner, probably these were buds of cannabis full of seeds. So these were flowering tops with seeds, and they are full of psychotomimetic tetrahydrocannabinol, so probably they were influenced by THC. And there was found also very interesting body preserved of one lady, which was full of tattoo, and they studied it and found that this lady, because the body was preserved, that she has breast cancer, and they found cannabis and coriander seeds. So they thought that probably it was used just to ease her pain during this cancer pain. In Judea, it's in Beth Shemesh, about 20 kilometers of Jerusalem, was found a tomb, old about 1,600 years, and in tomb was about 14-year-old girl, but she was pregnant because in her body was found also fetus, and was found some material, and they sent it to our lab, and we analyzed it and found that there was delta 8 THC, because delta 9 THC, this psychoactive compound, is not stable, and isomerized to delta 8 THC, what is stable compound, but about 10 times less potent than delta 9 THC. So this compound stayed over there for hundreds of years, and it was possible to identify it. So it was used probably to ease her pain when she wanted to give birth to this child, but her pelvis was not ready for that, so probably was some hemorrhage, and they tried cannabis. In ancient Rome, there is Pliny the Elder, and it's written that he used for inflammations extracts of roots, and similar Pedanius Dioscorides in the Rome also used cannabis roots just to treat inflammations. In the fact, at present time, extracts of cannabis roots are not used, and there are only several publications about cannabis roots, so maybe it's also some potential for the future. John Ruskin Reynolds, you probably know, because this was Queen physician, and he appreciated cannabis at his two publications, one Archive of Medicine and later in Lancet. And as you can see, every time he said that it's one of the best medicine which is in our reach. From this, it was very brief, and I jumped directly to Czechoslovakia, to Palacky University, where Professor Krejčí, at 1950, during his studies of antibiotic principle of higher plants, found that cannabis is wonderful antibacterially, and it was used all the time in Czechoslovakia, in hospital in Olomouc. I personally, from 1970 to 1990, prepared for drugstore cannabis extracts, what is called today cannabis oil. Incorrectly, it's extract, because then it's mixed with cannabis in oil, so I prefer to call it extract. So I prepare these extracts, and drugstore prepare just creams, because it was antibacterial, and it was used all these 20 years when I prepare it in the hospital in Olomouc. So Professor Krejčí, when he studied this, so he found that it's active against gram-positive microorganisms and some pathogens, and it was clinically studied in some clinics like otorhinolaryngology, gynecology, and so on. And already in 19, and this compound with Professor Shantavi, they tried to find what is this compound, and they found that this is cannabidiolic acid. And this was first cannabinoidic acid which was isolated and identified from cannabis. They published it at 1955. And already after this discovery, in 1954, was at Palacky University in Olomouc conference Konopia Kolek, Cannabis as Medicine. So as you can see, it's nothing new. Rebirth of medicinal cannabis was at the 60s at Palacký University. Excellent chemist was Professor František Šantavý, which elucidated structures S for cannabidiol, S for tetrahydrocannabinol. At 1963, Professor Meshulam published structure of cannabidiol, and he mentioned, of course, in this publication that at the same time informed him Professor Šantavý that he found the same structure. And Professor Šantavý also elucidated not only structure, but also absolute configuration of this compound. And in 1964, he published correct structure of THC with absolute configuration. And this is the structure what was published in University ACTA. Because it was a local journal, it's not such known around the world, even when Professor Šantavý cannabidiolic acid they published in Czech language, but this he published in English. And at the same time, Professor Yechiel Gaoni and Rafael Meshulam, at the time they worked at in Rechovod and Weizmann Institute, they published also, they isolated THC, and they also elucidated the structure the same as Professor Šantavý. So it often happens in science that on two place independently at the same time are the same results. Today, cannabis is very intensively studied, and today we know already 144 cannabinoids. These are compounds which are typical for cannabis, and you cannot find them in any other plant. And as you can see, over 1,000 are some other compounds which were identified. So the chemistry, it's not such easy. Today they are talking in connection with treatment only with THC and CBD, but there is a synergistic action of other compounds, so probably it will be more complicated. Not probably, but it's for sure that it's more complicated. In the fact, these cannabinoids, which are used for treatments, they are not in the plant. All these cannabinoids are in the plant like cannabinoidic acids, which start with cannabigerolic acid, and independently it goes to three directions, to cannabidiolic acid, tetrahydrocannabinolic acid, and cannabichromenic acid. And there are between these three acids no connection. So if you can read on the internet that you can prepare back at home from cannabidiol, tetrahydrocannabinol, or from tetrahydrocannabinol, cannabidiol. It's impossible. It's of course possible in the lab, but it's complicated, just like cannot do it. But it's known that mostly for treatment are important decarboxylated compounds, because we don't know too much about acids. We know about cannabidiolic acid, that is antibacterially active, not about other acids, but I am sure that they are also for treatment important. But today I use decarboxylated compounds. So this decarboxylation undergoes during harvest or during hardening of the resin on the flowering tops on the sun, and during storage, or you can heat it a little bit and you can have tetrahydrocannabinol. Tetrahydrocannabinol, which is used for treatment, so if you want to treat cancer, you need THC, not THCA. When it was clear what is the active compound of cannabis, which involves during use, recreational use, what is known to everybody today, so it's not necessary to explain it. So scientists wanted to know how it works in the body. And they were hunting for, because they expected that there will be probably some receptors. And in 1988 at St. Louis University, Dr. William Devane discovered in the brain central cannabinoid receptor, today is called CB1. And later was discovered peripheral cannabinoid receptor, which today is called CB2. If you look concerning abundance in the brain, so immediately when you see basal ganglia movement control, cerebellum body movement coordination, and so on, so it fits with what experience user of cannabis. So it means that this active compound from cannabis binds to the receptors and involves these actions. So scientists, when cannabinoid receptors were discovered, studied body, where are these receptors, and they found that CB1 are mainly in the brain and in reproductive organs, and CB2 receptors mostly in immune system. But today we know that cannabinoid receptors are almost anywhere. These are one of the most spread receptors in human body, and that is why so many diseases are influenced by cannabis. So it's not panacea, but because of these cannabinoid receptors, it influences so many diseases. If you look how is expression, so you see that CB1 receptors are mostly in cerebellum, and CB2 receptors mostly in spleen. But you see that also at high concentration are in islets of Langerhans, so immediately you understand why you can treat also diabetes with cannabinoids. So as soon as were cannabinoid receptors, so I was lucky that Finnish socialism in Czechoslovakia, and professor, it was in November 1989, and in February, because I was 16 years in contact with Professor Meshulam, he immediately invited me, and in September 1990, I was already at Hebrew University. He also invited specialist in molecular pharmacology. This was Dr. William Devane, discoverer of cannabinoid receptors. And I thought that I'm going to work on cannabis. He said, no, I need that you isolate from the brain compound which binds to cannabinoid receptors. Dr. Devane, discoverer of these receptors, had very sensitive bioassays. So we worked together. I isolated, he tested all these fractions, and so one without the other one couldn't be successful. So together we came after 1.5 years to the final compound, which was active for cannabinoid receptors, and we named this compound anandamide. Ananda is Sanskrit bris delight, because we thought that this is inner bris, this compound, what is true. This is on the right is Dr. William Devane with me, and chemically this compound is arachidonoyl ethanolamide. We didn't expect it that it's such simple compound. Nobody expected this. We thought first that it will be some peptide or something. But it was a very simple compound, and so ananda is bliss delight, and amide, this compound is ethanolamide. So we wanted what is behavior of this compound and what is chemical principle, so we named it anandamide. KI, so it is activity as it binds to the cannabinoid receptor, was around 40 nanomoles, and we were really surprised, because compound from higher plant, tetrahydrocannabinol, and compound from the brain, anandamide, they bind to the same places in the body, to cannabinoid receptors. And as I said, anandamide is around, KI is around 40 nanomoles, and THC is also around 40 nanomoles. So two different compounds from higher plant and from mammal body bind to the same place, what was really wonderful for us, this discovery. And cannabinoid system in the body is very complicated, and if you have partial list, which conditions they can affect, so when you read what they affect, so you see that it fits this influence of cannabis. I must go a little bit faster. It works in the body like key and lock. So key is this ligand, anandamide or tetrahydrocannabinol, and cannabinoid receptors are lock. So when key enters the lock, so we experience everything what we can see. It works through transmission, but we don't have, unfortunately, time, so very fast. It's synthesized in one nerve and goes to the other one, and after action in the body, it's reuptaked or it's metabolized. We discovered also 2-arachidonoyl glycerol, what was another endocannabinoid, and later we identified altogether 5, and 2 were identified in the United States. Somebody said action of endocannabinoids in 5 words: relax, eat, sleep, forget, protect. It's everything what are important actions in the body. Cannabis is wonderful medicine, but every time I tell for no, it doesn't cure. Every time it doesn't cure, everyone doesn't cure any disease, doesn't cure any stage of disease. So will be persons which will be treated fully, will be persons which will experience improvement in disease, but there are some patients, this is small part, that cannabis doesn't help them. And recently, two scientists at the National Institute of Health mentioned that cannabis probably will in the near future treat all diseases, and they support this strong statement with examples of experiment in vitro and on animals. To the end of my lecture, I would like to tell you how it's important. I checked it just 2 days ago, and on Web of Science, and today on cannabis and endocannabinoids are altogether 123,000 scientific publications. So you can see how this plant is important. Okay, thank you very much for your attention. Okay, so if there are questions, I apologize, I start to talk and then I saw that my time terminated.
Actually, you were perfectly very fast. On time. Thank you for this very interesting presentation about the history and the effects of cannabis. So now we have 10 minutes for questions. Most 10 percünk van kérdésekre. Úgyhogy először önöket kérdezném meg, hogy kinek van kérdése. Hogyha felteszik a kezüket, akkor a kolléganőm Réka oda megy a mikrofonnal. És azt kérném, hogyha kérdeznek, akkor mondják be a nevüket, hogyha gondolják, és azt, hogy milyen háttérből jönnek. Van esetleg kérdés?
Szendrai Kálmán, Szegedi Egyetem. Not so much question, no question actually, because I am myself you know, lecturing on the same subject, have been for the last 20 years. So, but just a souvenir, an old memory, because we know each other since the 80s, is it, from Olmütz. And to indicate to the organizers and also to the audience how much politics can influence the question of cannabis. We have been studying cannabis in Szeged. This is why I partially I went to see the group there, Professor Krejci and so on. And that there was a request by the UN, which was passed to the university. We had to perform the study at the Hungarian fiber plants to provide data on them. Once it was done, it was submitted, we published, fortunately, in international journals. So the UN liked the results, and then there was a continuation. But what happened when they invited me to Geneva, to the UN laboratory, to do the 3 months fellowship to perform a study, and I wanted to continue on cannabis. What happens, I am called in the foreign ministry by the head of the international department, and I am warned, Dr. Senray, you can do anything except cannabis. Please don't touch cannabis. You can imagine my disappointment. And for several years, I could not talk to the university students on cannabis, although I had done later further studies. Now, it makes the thing obviously like very complicated, and I don't need to explain the background, but the government was afraid that a crazy scientist goes to the UN laboratory and maybe finds something that is not pleasant for the government, for the politics, which was wrong, because the group in the US, Carlton, Turner, made what I wanted to do, but 5 years later. Thank you. I just wanted to tell you.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Senray, for his notes. And it's true that all rush around cannabis is artificial, because it's paradox when physicians tell you, I cannot prescribe you cannabis, I prescribe you morphine, it's no problem. So everybody understands that morphine is dangerous and cannabis is innocent plant, because when we cultivated it in Olomouc, it was without fence, it was accessible for anybody. I cultivated also strong strains. I never lost one leaf. Everybody who passed, hemp, and was no problem. So it's artificial. If I cultivate it over there today, even with fence, so it cannot survive overnight.
Thank you. Are there any other questions?
Jó napot, Bérteki Béla vagyok, és egy kérdésem, hogyha összehasonlítjuk az anandamid és a THC-nak a térbeli modelljét, akkor a... Ismét? Jó, tehát...
Yes.
Ja, üdvözlöm, Bérteki Béla. Egy kérdés van. Tehát, ha összehasonlítjuk a arandamid és a THC térbeli modelljét, akkor melyik rész az, ami a CB1-hez kapcsolódik? Mert hogy a térbeli modell a képen teljesen más. Egy pontot látok rajta. Van egy ilyen speciális neve, nem tudom most a nevét, nem emlékszek rá. Amikor a szén kapcsolódik szénhez, és arról a két hidrogén molekula. Itt alul szokták mutatni. Tehát, hogy mi az, ami kapcsolódik a CB1-hez valójában?
In the fact, if we look on the structure, so we can see only one similarity at THC and at anandamide, that from double bond goes pentyl side chain. It's also known what studied already Roger Adams in the United States at the 40s, that if he changed instead of pentyl side chain, dimethylheptyl side chain, which is used today often, so it's much more psychoactive, much more active compounds if they are dimethylheptyl instead of pentyl. So probably one of the reasons can be this side chain, but in the fact we have also some molecules, because some companies studied thousands or million molecules by computers, and they found molecules which has no similarity with THC and with anandamide, and they bind to cannabinoid receptors. Of course, we don't have enough knowledge about these compounds, how they can influence the body. And also, in the fact, I am not too much for synthetic compounds which are active to cannabinoid receptors, because we have a very bad experience. One compound derivative which was used for obesity, so some patients were depressed and suicided. And another compound, you know, from France, this was a blocker of anandamide metabolization. So patients also, they had damaged brain or died. So one must be very careful, and every time I say that man cannot be the nature. Every time it's found that natural compound is better than synthetic compound. I cannot tell you more details about compound versus cannabinoid receptor.
Any other questions? We have time for one more question. There is one here.
Thank you. As a researcher, how do you see the future of cannabis research? What are the most exciting new ways of cannabis research in the future?
I'm sorry, you said it in English and I heard it in Hungarian.
So I repeat it. So as a researcher, how do you see the future of cannabis research? What are the most exciting new ways of cannabis research? What discoveries do you expect?
Cannabis is wonderful medicine, but as I mentioned, my 4-0, I stay for that. But already patients which are treated illegally, they are more experienced than scientists and everybody, because I met persons which treated cancer fully. I met persons which improved their illness, and I saw patients and they told me that cannabis didn't help them. So we don't have enough knowledge, because it's known today that if you have two strains, all the time we are talking today only about CBD and THC and their ratio in the plant. But if you have two different strains with the same amount of ratio of these two compounds, one strain treats you but not the other one. It means that there is synergy of other compounds, and this we still don't know. It looks that probably these compounds can be terpenes. It looks that this compound probably can be flavonoids. Maybe this can be also other compounds. So it's worth to study it, and if we shall collect the best analysis of the strain which use patient, all history about treatment of this patient, all history about his anamnesis of his family, and all informations of physician together. So maybe in 10 years we can have good informations how to treat patients and how he used the cannabis, because there are different ways of using, and some of them have advantage and are not used, like suppositories. It's not used too much, and it's one of the best possibilities how patient can use it without high, because patient doesn't want to have high in his head or her head, wants only be treated. So still we have a lot of what to do. You know, it's known 1,000 years, and I studied already 46 years, and Professor Meshulam over 50 years, and still we don't have enough information. The problem is also because of illegality, because I was in many countries, I met interesting strains which I would like to analyze. I cannot bring it. If I bring it to Israel, penalties 20 years in jail maximum. So nobody cares that I am a scientist. So there are about 27,000 patients, cannabis patients, but use it outside of this range is really serious penalty, 20 years in jail. So if you give it under age 18, it's 25 years. And recently still was when you had bong, so bong was 5 years jail. Souvenir. So it's not such easy, it's very complicated. And then mostly physicians are against cannabis. You say cannabis, and they see that they already go with police. So they don't want to talk about cannabis, they don't want anything connected with cannabis. And some patients are afraid because they believe only in classical medicine with side effects. They don't believe to cannabis without side effects. So this is also a problem.
Thank you very much, Lumiere. And there will be a roundtable discussion in the afternoon with Lumiere, so you will have the possibility to ask more questions from him. És most szeretném bemutatni önöknek a következő előadónkat, Dr. Ilja Rezniket, aki a kanabionid alapú terápiák alkalmazása a neurológiában és a pszichiátriában címmel fog előadást tartani. Dr. Reznik klinikai neuropszichiáter, fő területe a gyógyászati kanabisz és kanabisz származékok használata. Olyan betegségek esetében, mint a krónikus fájdalom, a posztraumás stressz-szindróma, OCD, Tourette-szindróma, Parkinson-kor és az Alzheimer betegség. Úgyhogy most megkérném Dr. Rezniket. I would like to ask Dr. Reznik to give his presentation.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for inviting me to this exciting event. First cannabinoid, most probably first cannabinoid devoted meeting in your country. I have a great pleasure to congratulate you with this very important event. For this moment, I suppose we just make a history, building some kind of new ways of medicine for the future years. In this way, I would like to introduce myself a little bit more, because I am a conventional physician, and this is very important to show you how a conventional physician could find his way from mainstream medicine to so-called cannabinoid medicine, making some example for many other physicians in all over the world how to change their practice, being more careful for our patients. First, I would like to describe my previous experience. I was graduated in Moscow 27 years ago, and I was graduated in Israel as a psychiatrist, as a forensic psychiatrist, and further I had my neurological and neuropsychiatry and psychopharmacology fellowship in the United States. So I was conventionally taught that my attitudes to the cannabis should be to dangerous narcotic drug. But continuously, when I worked in this field, I felt that my own experience devoted to the patients and listening to them, I began to understand that my patients, a majority of them, suffered from anxiety, post-traumatic stress disorder. They treat themselves, and they reported me that we use cannabis frequently. So in those times, we considered it as a double illness, double disorder, so drug addiction and mental illness. But continuously, I began to understand that it is just not right. It is just not true. Patients found their way how to treat themselves, and they are helping themselves by various ways. We need to listen to them and probably to adopt their practice to our clinical experience. And I began to understand that probably we should change our practice. Those time I was in charge for a clinical research unit in our university, mental health center. So I tried to investigate cannabis properties in the walls of our mental health center, but it was not possible those time. And I began to use most frequently cannabis for my post-traumatic and anxiety patients. During the recent time, I began to be more and more involved to various cannabinoids research. And currently, I serve as a parliament advisor for our parliament subcommittee for cannabis regulation, as advisor and observer, in order to assist to our politicians to change current laws, be closer to patient needs. And we succeeded in Israel to build one of the best programs in the world, but not perfect one, how to treat patients using cannabis for their medical purposes. I do not have any kind of financial interest in this field, other than treating my patients using not only classical pharmaceutical agents, but also using cannabinoids in the form that allowed in our country. I would like to share with you some points of using cannabinoids in neurology and probably in psychiatry. If you will have time, I will be happy to answer your two questions. Just for overlook, I would like to show you that cannabis is progressively coming to the mainstream. Several months ago, Nature, this is a basic and probably most important scientific journal, published the whole issue devoted to the cannabis and cannabis science, cannabis medicine, saying that now from this moment, cannabis is a part of mainstream. It is not a bad son or abandoned method that had hidden many years before. Now we are bringing cannabis to the mainstream of the science, of the medicine. So this is a crucial point. Even in so conservative societies like American Society of Neurology published in the recent journal that cannabis obviously has very good properties for spasticity, for many neurological disorders, especially for spasticity like multiple sclerosis, Parkinson's disease, etc., etc. We can also say that even this review, that is not probably so exaggerating use of cannabis, but they also saying that there is an obvious role of various cannabinoids in the treating of various neurological diseases. What kind of disorder we can treat with cannabis in this field? Sure, we can use it for neurodegenerative disorders, the disorders that making our nervous system putting to neurodegeneration process. We could not understand how these processes are began with, but we can understand how we can probably to reduce the speed of the grave results. I'm saying about Parkinson's disease, about Alzheimer's disease, about Huntington's disease, that major neurodegenerative disorders. In all of them, we have a very good experience using cannabis and cannabinoids in various forms in our country and in also in several other countries. I'm happy that I present you my presentation just after Professor Hanus say that overviewed all this cannabinoid system, so you understand that CB1 receptors and the CB2 receptors probably working together. They are main point of working of cannabinoids in our body. So for it's very important for neurological disorders. In our country, we use several indications for using cannabis. For example, multiple sclerosis is the second major indication in Israel where we treating patients with cannabinoids. It's allowed, and the majority of the multiple sclerosis patients who applied for license already granted with this license. This process is not easy, but we really supply good quality medicinal cannabis for very low prices for such patients. Also, I have a very good my personal experience with Tourette patients. You know, Tourette disorder, Gilles de la Tourette disorder. This is a disorder of young adulthood and adult young teenagers, young adults. So this is a very important disorder, neurological disorder that has a neuropsychiatric triad. It's going with obsessive compulsive symptoms, attention deficit disorder, and tics, motor and vocal tics. So this is very important to understand how could we prescribe cannabis for youngsters. In this concern, we should say that obviously cannabis could be harmful for some young people, but we need to understand if we could make some clinical experience with them, we could probably deliver very cannabis to such patients in very safe mode. So we should not be frightened to prescribe cannabis for such people, because cannabis is a short acting medication. We can see if they have side effects or what kind of positive effect we can see for them, for their tics, for their vocal tics, motor tics, for their obsessions. So we can see it quite soon. And in case we have some troubles with this, some side or unwanted effects, we could stop it for them without any consequences. So this is my my experience with Tourette disorder is very positive for them. We just need to understand. I wanted to show you this. You have on the YouTube. I'm not sure that we have time to see this film. On YouTube, you can find under the cannabis and Tourette syndrome very good films showing the effect of cannabis on the Tourette symptoms. Is because this is a motor or vocal tics, you can see it sharp on the your screen how it works on these patients. We just need to put major symptoms to our target and saying for us we what kind of symptoms we would like to eradicate to such patients. And my advice to all clinicians that in the audience. My recommendation is very, very clear. Begin low dose and go slowly, and you will find the results. You will find the proper dosage, and you will give. You will see the good results in these patients. Also, we have a very good experience for Alzheimer's disorder. We could not cure currently on the current state of art. We could not cure Alzheimer's disorder with cannabis, but we can reduce many symptoms that are going with this disorder. We have very good experience in one of our nursing homes for more than 60 patients that have been given cannabis for the 5 years, and they had a very disabled condition, and we improved the quality of life of them very drastically. Me working as a neuropsychiatrist, and they have a geriatric physician in their nursing homes, they had a great improvement in the quality of their life. They have improvement in all scales we just observed in such patients. In the such patients, we had a general improvement in well-being, in quality of life, and also we reduced drastically all medicine they had before, such as sedatives, such as anxiolytics, and antihypertensive medication. You know, the cannabis properties is to reduce blood pressure, to reduce glucose blood levels. We almost reduced all kind of antidiabetic and antihypertensive medications to them. The chief nurse of this nursing home was very happy that the cost of their treatment reduced drastically, but unfortunately we had more than 1 kilo of cannabis each time, and the Ministry of Health closed this program because we could not keep it in safe under requirement of Ministry of Health. But I recommend to adopt part or our full experience to your own needs. And when cannabis will be available in your country, I suppose this is, should be one of the first indication to use cannabis for elderly people. You just have nothing to lose. You may help them or not help, but you will not make their condition worse. We did not observe any kind of unwanted side effects or unwanted, unpleasant results. For some patients, it was very effective. For other patients, it was less effective. But because we are speaking about very safe medication, you will be, find the very good result for them without any kind of toxicity. So please take it in your consideration. Another example is the use of cannabis in psychiatric patients, like in schizophrenia. In this case, I would like to say that in majority of the cases, when cannabis was described like the schizophrenogenic substance, is just not right, because majority of these papers were written many years where. Researchers did not distinguish between street drugs like synthetic cannabinoids and cannabis itself. So the blame cannabis for schizophrenogenic properties is just not true. We use even in Israel cannabis for some schizophrenia patients without any exacerbation of their needs. We use it for concomitant neurological disorders. We use it for concomitant Tourette syndromes. And for the last 5 years, we did not observe any one exacerbation. We use it in Israel for almost 25,000 patients now, and we did not observe psychotic exacerbation in them. We have maybe five cases of some anxiety or psychotic experience in such large category of patients. Is much lesser than that could be expected, having that we, by statistics, we are having almost 1 or 2% of schizophrenics in schizophrenia patients among population. So the rate of probable psychotic exacerbation is very, very low. We are making several trials using various cannabinoids as a potential agents to treat psychosis. So we could suggest such treatment as a very safe and probably very helpful, but we just need to know how we could adopt each kind of cannabinoids, each kind of cannabis strain to each particular patient. As it was said by Professor Hanush, we need to understand better our ability to help these patients, how to fit each kind of strains to such patients. We have also very good experience to treat patients with anxiety, depression, and post-traumatic stress disorder. Unfortunately, we do not have enough time to describe all our experience. I just review it in brief that we had a trial with post-traumatic stress disorder patients. Unfortunately, our Ministry of Health granted only for half of them a license for use medical cannabis for unknown reasons, but now we have about 700 post-traumatic stress disorder patients treated in Israel with cannabis. This is a good result, and we have a very good result. I just want you to describe our results in our study. It was observational study, just extended case series study, where we observed very good results, giving them just observing them using their cannabis, together with other painkillers, sedative, anti-oxalytics, antidepressive medications. At the end of this study, we observed just a reduction of the post-traumatic stress symptoms, reduction of the anxiety, improvement in their sleep, in quality of their life. We observed that in the group of patients that have also concomitant post-traumatic stress symptoms, depressive symptoms, and pain symptoms, the cannabis worked as best as it could. So my opinion that we should adjust to such kind of patients, anxiety patients, with depression, with pain symptoms, cannabis is probably most effective treatment, and not to keep it as a fourth or the fifth or sixth line of treatment like it being done in Israel, because now in Israel we could not suggest them to use cannabis as a first or second line like it should be done. We just using it for the very most severe cases that is just making big discrimination to such patients. My final remarks are that we should consider cannabis, in particular all patients that coming to our clinical attendance. We should consider it as a first line or the second line according to the patient's preferences. We should listen carefully to our patients, to their own experience, and be ready to provide them good quality cannabis for reasonable prices, and to allow them to continue their medical treatment under the current follow-up. But we just need to train doctors, to educate doctors, family members, caregivers on all levels, pharmacists, psychologists, how to use cannabinoid medicine. And this way, I would like to show you again that cannabis now is here. Cannabis may be not closer to your country, but it will be here, I'm sure. I have no doubt about it, because we came here just from Macedonia that legalized cannabis for medical use just 1 month ago, and we are trying to help them to educate them, their physicians. We need to understand the cannabis now, cannabinoid-based medicine, this is a mainstream. Now this is not an orphan, this is a mainstream of modern medicine. I would like to mention that I'm here on the behalf of Central Committee and the Directory of International Association of Cannabinoid Medicine, Cannabis as Medicine, and I would like you to invite to visit our website. Our website is free. All websites are free for doctors, for educators, for scientists, for patients. Please visit our website. Read all papers, all the database, that all papers that published there. I also would like to introduce you to the other websites, such as Canadian Consortium for Cannabinoid Investigation. This is our partner association. They have a very good educational online educational programs. And also, I would like you to show you the to visit site for American for Access. I hope Steph will say more, tell us more about it. But there are best sites in the world web. Just visit us and to increase your knowledge in this field. I would like to say hello and to appreciate your attentions, and I will be happy to answer your questions. Thank you.
Mielőtt a kérdésekhez térünk, szeretném üdvözölni dr. Kelemen Annát, és köszönjük, hogy eljött hozzánk, és ő lesz a következő előadó. De mielőtt rátérnek a következő előadásra, újra lehetőséget szeretnénk adni a kérdezésre. Ahogy van bárkinek kérdése, akkor kérem, hogy tegye fel a kezét, és akkor adunk egy mikrofont, és a nevüket és az intézményüket kérem, hogy jelezzék.
Köszönöm. Már azt hiszem, bemutatkoztam Szendrei, Szeged Egyetem. So let me raise a few basic questions. In such presentations, very often it remains unclear what is the material, the preparation you are using in Israel? There may be several, I am not sure, but since Israel has been for a long time the main producer for scientific purposes of all the important cannabinoids, for obvious reasons, we even at the UN lab were purchasing from Israel the standard material. So I would suspect or assume that the material you are using principally is THC. And this coincides with your final slide, where you said in medicine THC has a place, but that is THC and not cannabis. I want to make this very clear, if we should never mix this up. What are you using in the clinical practice for various syndromes and indications? Is it cannabis herb, cannabis extract, or tincture, or whatever, or pure cannabinoid THC, or other? This is very important. The second question, and that's all, is the regulation. I have heard that it is not so easy to bring in material to Israel, and I know very well, I think quite well, the Israeli regulation. I know that both medicinal regulation and the illicit drug regulation are quite tight, quite serious, quite advanced, and then the question is, how can you then have all these drugs used in such an extent as you are doing it? You have a special license, you must have a special license, or you are not having a special license, etc. Thank you.
Thank you for excellent question. You know, the excellent question, the difference between good question and excellent question, that good question that I have an answer an excellent question. I have also a slide for this. My appreciation to all physicians and scientists and doctors here. I would like to understand that even we have a long-standing experience researching cannabis, like it was described by Professor Hanush, we currently have a medical cannabis program only for last 8 years, and we gradually learned together with our patients how to treat them. Concomitantly, our regulators also learned a little, very little, how to regulate it. So currently we have in Israel an available plant material. We have plant material and extracts for with THC and CBD content. We also have cookies, but it's only allowed only for children. They are produced by suppliers, official growers that have a license for growing and to producing tincture extracts and cookies. So all three of these options are available for all patients for a reasonable price, almost free. I'm saying it's again, it's almost free. In spite that the prices for cannabis in the world are very high, Israeli patients have access to very good quality medical cannabis in various forms, as a dry material, as extracts or cookies for children, almost for $100 as a flat rate, even for 20 gram, even for 100 gram, at the same price for the very good quality material. Quality, you know, should be better ever, and our Minister of Health should look better for quality of material, but now it's a matter of further regulation and changes in our oncoming reform. We already on the way to another reform in cannabis practice, but it will be next year. I will be happy to be with you next year and to report you the results of our ongoing reform, how our ministry is going to improve current regulation. It is the second question, it was what about regulation? Our regulation is quite simple, but on the functioning, it's not simple. Regulation saying that all physicians, all specialists in Israel possess the rights to recommend cannabis as a medicine for their own patients under their own field. So neurologists should recommend cannabis only for neurological disorders, psychiatrists only for post-traumatic stress disorder because it's only indication now, and oncologists only for oncology. We have other indications like infectious disease, HIV. Infectious disease specialists could recommend it to Ministry of Health, and Ministry of Health has their own view on this, and sometimes they agree to grant such license for such patients, sometimes they do not agree. Now we have about 50% of approval level, so only 50% of our application to cannabis are satisfied by the Ministry of Health. You can say this is a bad, I'm saying this is a bad approach. Somebody else could say this is a good approach because even under such high suspicious rate from authorities, we have more than 25,000 currently treated patients. So this is a balance between two powers, like as a parliament that insists to provide more cannabis for more patients, for more indications, and Ministry of Health that listening to our medical association and medical units are saying, no, please reduce the rate of granting licenses. So a conflict between two of these authorities creating such a situation where we really have very good regulation, but functionally we are able to obtain a license only to half patients we needed to be treated with cannabis. Did I answer your question?
Thank you. Köszönjük, thank you. Any other questions? If there's no question, then I have one for both Lumiere and Ilya. You spoke about the history of cannabis and its use, and you also spoke about very interesting research and the effects of cannabis. And the reservations that you mentioned can be made for any kind of medicine. So my question is, looking at the regulation and the difficulties with tests, my question is very simple: what went wrong? Why we are in this phase when there are so strict regulations to cannabis that doesn't apply to other plants?
May I try to answer?
Both of you.
I can tell you one thing. Our minister said it about 2 months on TV, that the biggest problem are pharmaceutical companies and money.
I would like to say that the process, we now hear, because the world is changing, it was impossible to perform such conference 2-3 years ago. The process of demonization of cannabis had begun 70 years ago with demonization of cannabis, mystification of cannabis, and 4 generations of doctors were brainwashed and understand that cannabis is a dangerous narcotic drug, and his regulation was under narcotic law, criminal law, and it was not considered could have any kind of medical use at all. So now the main difficulties is to change doctors and regulators' attitudes. First, the doctors should change their attitude toward the cannabis to understand all of these abilities. We are looking further, could understand that cannabis could be a useful medication for almost 40-45% for all patients we have in population. So we just need to change current regulations and doctor views, and this is why we could have cannabis available for the next generations.
Thank you very much for your answers and your presentation as well.